What's up, everybody? Welcome to IGN GameScoop. I'm your host, Damon Hatfield. Joining me this week are Sam Claiborne.
Hey, Damon.
Justin Davis.
Scoop.
And Mark Medina joins us this week.
We're going to get 20 questions this time, I promise.
That's your, like, catchphrase, like, hey, gamers, that you spent time coming up with.
We're going to get 20 questions this time, I promise.
We workshopped that
Mark
one.
Mark Medina, IGN.com.
We've got a great show for you this week. I think I've done a good job of making something out of nothing. It's a very slow news week. And when that happens, I often go to you, the viewers and listeners, for your questions in the GameScoop inbox. I got a really interesting question that sent me down a rabbit hole, and it's going to be some good stuff. So we're going to end up talking about our main topic, forgotten PlayStation games. And there are a lot of games that were both developed and published by Sony that I think some of you will be like, what? It's pretty good.
I know. Okay.
We get them on 20 already. Questions, or should I say we don't get them on 20 questions.
Yeah. You know, Damon, a rabbit hole is the best kind of hole. So.
You think that's true? Yeah.
Yeah, or hobbit hole maybe. Okay, second hobbit hole.
Pretty good.
Pretty cozy.
Wow, you were so definitive and then talked yourself out of it almost immediately.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's not a dirty, dank, gross hole full of worms and dirt, but a nice, lovely hole.
Yep. Got it. Exactly.
Please move on.
But first, was anyone aware that there is a new Puyo Puyo-like just announced? Anyone aware of this? And it
if anybody was aware, it might be you.
This is the name of our new column. Was anyone aware of this?
That should be my column. It's set in the Super Meat Boy universe.
Oh, no, I didn't see, I take it back. I did see that. Yeah, it looks cool.
It's called Dr. Fetus's Mean Meat Machine. And it looks really cool. It looks very Puyo Puyo-ish. It says that there's also the Super Meat Boy platforming elements to it. I don't really know how those come into play, but the gameplay that I've seen looks like Puyo Puyo, and it looks very cool. And it's coming out this year. And that was just an
I'm glad they're keeping the Mean Machine series going in at least spirit.
Dr. Robotnik would be proud.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, the Mean Bean. Yeah, Mean Bean Machine for sure. Anyway.
Bold of them to put Dr. Fetus in the name of the game.
I mean, I don't know if you've played Super Meat Boy or Binding of Isaac, but...
I mean, yeah, but they're not in the title of the game and on the box.
Hey, Mom, you know what game I'd like you to buy me?
I don't think too many kids care about playing games set in the, what is it, the Super Meat Boy, the SMBU?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm. Sure. Man, anyway. Super Meat Boy was really good.
Mm-hmm. Was really good. That was just a little something for me to kick the show off with. Sam, you've seen the Tetris movie.
I did. I watched it with Alexei Pajitnov, which was amazing.
Whoa.
It was definitely a defining experience in terms of being a fan of Tetris my entire life, and what an honor. But yeah, the movie I thought was absolutely fantastic. It's hard to get a grip on how kind of measured and well done it is, because the trailer is really, it really kind of shows these over-the-top moments. But like, it tells this story, which is partially this like crazy story of like, how did this game get out of Russia? How did it become marketed in the United States? Well, it was through the efforts of a guy named Hank, and he's the main character in this movie with that classy mustache. But the other characters they're showing here are all real people too, like Minoru Arakawa, the NOA vice president, Howard Lincoln, and then of course there's a great inside Kyoto Nintendo scene as well, with Yamauchi. It's for that type of stuff. Like, they went all in making these really cool sets in Russia and in Japan and the United States that were like 80s game studios, which is like, who's done that before? Cool. It's just really well done. And the producers of the movie are the Tetris company, the people that are also the characters in the movie who are there. And they're striving for a good story with some accuracy. And, you know, I got to hear them talk about that, which was great. I loved it. I thought it was like really fun to watch and really heartwarming. And it's just an important story. Like, it's a really neat idea, because, and you'll understand a little bit about video games back then, which was really crazy, which is like, you know, if there was like a hit game, one company would publish on PC. One would publish in arcades in America, mm-hmm. one in arcades in Japan, another one would have it on, you know, on consoles. And like, that was like, for this game was like, people saw it and felt it as such a hit so quickly. that it was vicious figuring out how to get it out. And it's really cool. Plus, you got this major player, which is the Soviet Union, which is like, we're anti-capitalist. Like, we they're only doing this by trying to make money for the government. So the players are not like a software company. They're like a guy, you know, Alexei, that works in a computer lab, and then like the government, you know, and they did not take kindly to American businessmen coming over and trying to buy video games. So that's what the action is about. It's great. Mm.
That's awesome. Questions? I'm glad to hear that from you, because like I think reviews have been a little bit more lukewarm across the board, but I trust Sam's opinion.
I mean, you know, this audience too, that listens to 20 Questions and listens to our retro segments and stuff, like there's just a lot of like, again, like the recreation of 80s stuff. That see, they have a CES scene.
Yeah.
Like, that's extensive. And like seeing that early CES scene is like, it's just cool. Like, I don't know how accurate it was. I wasn't there, but it looks like it should. And it's just like, you're just constantly looking around and seeing all the cool things that they're kind of showing. It was really enjoyable.
Cool.
It's awesome. I mean, I feel like everyone's subscribed to Apple TV Plus for Ted Lasso again. Mm-hmm. So, hey, while you're here, watch the Tetris movie.
Yeah, exactly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's out next week, right? On the 31st, I want to say.
Nobody knows.
I don't know.
Something like that. I'm going to check it out now. And Mark, we talked a lot about Resident Evil 4 last week, but let's get your thoughts on it. Thumbs up or thumbs down?
Sure. Very, very thumbs up. Yes. Mm-hmm. I thought it was very good. I never really played the original. And so we did one of those like how long to beat videos. And they were like, do you have any interesting, like, did you beat it in a certain way? And I was like, no, but I beat it in a way as in like, I'm the only one on this list that hasn't played the original. And my time was just as like good as everybody else's. So that was good. I liked it a lot. I'm sad that I never played the original now, because I think I would have liked it, because I like this game quite a bit. But then
you know
when
what? I have a fun take on that, Mark. That the original is so different from the remake, which now that I'm even further into the remake, I can't believe how different it is. It is a completely remade game. There's not like entire parts which are like this. Well, I don't think anything matches. Like the game map doesn't match. Like cool. you don't go around, you don't go to the same rooms or anything like that. So it's really crazy different. So you could go back and play RE4 now. It's playable and fun, and you know, you might have a good experience. But
yeah, in my script, I say something about like, it's been this long since the game came out and I can finally say that I've beaten it. And somebody was like, well, hold on. In the comments on the YouTube video, they were like, hold on. You've beaten the remake. Like, let's, you know, and I was like, oh, yeah, that's not inaccurate. But no, I thought it was really, really good. I liked it a lot. And it was just like when I beat Village, I instantly wanted to just go back in, because it's kind of weird. That game almost, because Village did this as well, it almost becomes almost like a roguelike where every time you play it, you do New Game Plus and you keep everything before. Mm-hmm. And so I'm like, okay, I kind of want to play through it on the really hardest difficulty. So let me play through it again on the really easy difficulty and get as much money as I can so I can buy a bunch of upgrades. And then I'll play through it again on the hardest difficulty and I'll have all these upgrades and stuff like that. And it's a weird way to like look at it. But
can you choose professional, the hardest difficulty, if you've only played through on easy?
Well, so my first playthrough was through standard.
Yeah, no, I know. But like, can you, I don't know if you can up your difficulty level with your stuff.
Well, so, oh, okay. Well, I guess I don't know if you keep your stuff. I played on standard, and then when I went to play again, you load through that save, and then it was like, what difficulty do you want to play on? And professional and stuff was there. So I guess what you're saying is if I had picked a harder one, my stuff wouldn't have been there. I don't know.
I don't think so. You can check it out, but I think the point is you have to beat it on that. That's what it was in the old ones, and that's why I used to beat it on professional, because you could the hardest difficulties. Because when you do that, you get to play again with like an infinite launcher or something, and then it's it's the hardest mode, but you have a Plagueis removal laser, and it's really fun. So like it's stuff like that, which makes it really interesting. But you're absolutely right though. Like the replayability has, starting with Resident Evil 4, the original, they basically made it like an arcade game, and they made it even more like that now with like actual pachinko stuff in this game, or actual what do you call them?
The target random challenges?
Random opening things. But actually, what I'm talking about though is like you can purchase with, you know, from challenge points, like cool upgrades to play through again. It's kind of like Halo. when you used to be able to turn on the skulls after you get
right,
them.
Right.
And it kind of changes the gameplay and stuff like that. I love that. I think it's so smart.
Well, that is something I'm trying to do right now, is I want to beat it in 4 hours, because that's one of the challenges, is to try to beat it like super crazy.
There's people on our team that have done that too, and that's how you do. You can totally drop down to easy, have a bunch of weapons and stuff, and like an infinite weapon, and like cruise through the game, which sounds so fun.
This
four
game,
hours.
I don't know if this is a spoiler or not. Now I'm curious. Did this game bring back that weird little Napoleon man boy?
Yeah, see, in this game, redid him, and he's really spooky and like
strange.
You know, the same kind of ways, but he looks like really gross now. And then there's like little elements of him in the collectibles, and then this other, there's that mechanical boss, the automaton, which is different in this. So it's like his little stuff is everywhere. There's a side quest where you have to egg a painting of him.
It's so weird. And then it's already weird, but then it's if you think about it for more than a second, they had how many meetings where someone somewhere was like, no, I want to put this weird little Napoleon man in the game. And everyone's like, I don't know about that. And then he's like, no, it's going to be great. Trust me. And then it is great.
Does he have a boss fight in the original?
Yeah, he turns into a plant.
Okay, so his boss fight in the remake was my favorite boss fight of the game. I thought it was very,
it's different.
Very
all the boss fights are different in the remake. They just have the visage or the appearance of their original, but then they play out kind of differently. Dead Space did that really well too, where they kind of changed up the boss fights.
What I did read, and this is kind of, and I people probably won't be happy, but what I kind of read is that this game has a ton of quality of life stuff, as far as opening barrels, you just go up and push X and he just roundhouse kicks them. And then apparently Ashley was very frustrating to kind of she had a health bar and stuff. And in this game, you just walk up and you just pick her up and she's good. So those are the things I'm worried about going back and being I can't aim and walk at the same time. What is that? Those are the things I'm worried about. But I do love the game a lot. I thought it was very good. Code Veronica next. Capcom, please.
Sam, there's enemies that are they're wearing knight full suits of armor,
Yeah.
They're motionless until they're activated by something. How long have... There's been something inside this whole time. How long? Just, weeks, days?
They were waiting for you to move that picture. And now they're like, what?
there's backstory and documents in the game. And one of them is that the original family, this is all, from the other game too. The original family had locked the Plagas away in their dungeons. And they were sealed it away, and they could come out of amber and all this stuff, right? So that was this backstory. So then the knights, they actually mention, which are we sealed off our crypt because of the haunted knights. So it's kind of the Plagas will always, go into some kind of humanoid form and attack. It's just it's pulpy, but they do try to explain stuff like that, which I think is really cool.
Yeah. And Sam, you were talking about how different it is. I think they've redone all the puzzles. I don't think any of the 100%. Puzzles are the same.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Yeah. There's a church one where you kind of overlay these colors, which I'm like, I remember that one. Nothing else. Everything is completely different.
Wait, that stained glass puzzle is in the original? Yeah. So the editor who edited that How Long to Beat video took out a section where I was I kind of breezed through the game, except for the stained glass part. I got stuck. I had no idea what I was supposed to be doing on that part. Yeah. But,
it's hard to write a guide about that too.
Because you can only write about it from its most neutral state. The second you mess with it once, you can't do anything. I discovered that I didn't have one of the switches on there. But then when that, it still took me I'm just bzz, 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 just turning these things and I just. Oh my gosh.
Look up Mark's video guide for that one. Y'all. I wish I would have had that at the time. It's fine. You spin stuff for long enough and you start seeing what you're supposed to be doing. Mm-hmm. Yeah, all the puzzles are different. All the bosses are different. And the layouts of every single area are different especially after the village. And it's just shocking.
Hmm. And Mark, I'm in the castle. I just took control of Ashley for the first time. So what percentage of the way through do you think?
Oh my gosh. So I didn't know how long this game was. Resident Evils are traditionally not that long. I think I beat Village for the first time in 8 hours. So maybe halfway, if even. The game is so long, so much longer than I thought. Real quick, can I mention something else I've been playing?
Yes.
No.
I've been playing the HBO app on my television. Mm-hmm. I watched all of AMC's Interview with a Vampire. Oh, sorry, not HBO, Amazon Prime. That show is great. If you
It was really good.
If you like the movie, this show is almost a sequel to the movie. It's definitely not. They definitely don't even try to pretend that this is any sort of sequel. But
You've seen the movie Interview with a Vampire?
One of my favorite movies of all time. That movie's great.
You've never seen The Big Lebowski?
The big what now? I have to give the audience something. I've never seen it. But the events of the movie did not happen in the show, and yet at the same time, they did. It's not a sequel, but it kind of is. It's really good.
That show also goes really hard. Like, we put on the first episode being like, I don't know, like, we're trying to find something to watch. And then that show, it's like, damn, like, you didn't need to go all out like this. Like, but it really does, from, like, you know, the acting and the costumes and the set design and, like, it's just, like, it's very, like, it's very intense and in your face. And I think it won a bunch of awards, and they're well-deserved.
Yeah, nice. It's great.
I'm into it.
Well, speaking of, before we started shooting, Sam and Justin were talking about Picard season 3. And how Sir Patrick Stewart, like you said, it was great, but it's pretty obvious how up there in years Sir Patrick Stewart is getting. I'm watching another show right now with a movie star who's getting up there in years. Sam, what just happened? Just blow a fuse?
One of the games blew a fuse. It looks like.
Well, at least you're still here.
Is it okay? Do you need to investigate anything?
No, it's on its own circuit. It looks fine.
Okay. Now the space looks haunted. It's very different.
Yeah, I need to go flip the switch. Give me a second. I'll just go switch it back on.
Okay.
I was running a space heater, you see, and so.
Is it that cold there?
It is cold out here in California. Mark, what's the temperature where you are?
So cold.
You're more
checking right now. It is 57 degrees.
Yeah, it's like that here too. It's cold everywhere out here. Yeah. Okay. Anyway. The TV show I've been watching that has another aging movie star is Shrinking on Apple TV Plus with Harrison Ford. And we were just talking about it with Justin. Justin said he watched the first episode, didn't do much for him. And I agree. It took me 2 or 3 episodes to really get in there. But now there's only one episode to go. It's not out yet. But now I laugh out loud every episode. That's really good. And it's like, it's Jason Segel is a psychiatrist whose wife recently passed away, and he's been grieving and neglecting his teenage daughter. And he also, his mentor at work is Harrison Ford, another psychiatrist. And so it's like, he's like dealing with all that and starting to emerge out of his period of grief and that, all that sort of thing. But well, I do agree, it takes a couple episodes to hook you. Once it does, it's very, very funny.
Awesome.
Yeah.
It's a good recommendation.
I like it.
Is anybody going to watch Hello Tomorrow on Apple TV Plus?
I don't know
it
that one.
It looks like Fallout. It's like, it's like takes place in the 50s, and yet the cars are like floating and stuff like that. And it looks really high production value, which is nuts because there's a Fallout show coming out. But like, this looks like Fallout, and it has a lot of the characters from other Apple TV stuff, like a lot of the actors from like Morning Show and stuff like that. It looks really, really cool.
Let's check in with the listeners.
Hey, listeners.
Listeners, remember you can always reach us at the email address, gamescoop@ign.com, just like Jared in Texas did, who says, hello, after all this talk about Microsoft possibly acquiring the rights to juggernaut franchise Call of Duty, it got me wondering about how Sony might combat this business move. I remember growing up loving the Killzone games, but after Guerrilla moved on to Horizon, it's less likely they would revive that franchise. Perhaps even another IP could be revived, such as Resistance or another personal favorite of mine, SOCOM. What routes do you and your peers believe would be the smartest move to try to lessen the damage of Microsoft, possibly dominating the military shooter genre? And what are some of your favorite discontinued Sony shooter IPs? I look forward to your words of wisdom. Thanks from a big fan. It's true.
Well, they own Bungie, so that's that's just my go-to is we know Bungie's working on something other than the next Destiny. And so it's like my thoughts are Bungie has shooting down. They just need to figure out how to make it not, you know, and it's really hard for a shared world shooter to compare, to compete against something like Call of Duty. Like, knowing that you have to go into the Crucible by building up your character in other ways, like, that's not stuff people want to, that's not something that can compete with Call of Duty, which is you log in, you go to multiplayer, and you're playing the game, right? So, they just, I think that they should leverage that talent. I just don't know what the game is. It's really hard to take down Call of Duty. That game is just synonymous with shooters. Everybody buys it every year, and It's just, it is what it is.
Well, it used to be Battlefield took it on, but
yeah,
Battlefield's really thinned out its kind of audience over the years with some games that people didn't take to right away. But I hear, you know, they ended up improving.
Mm-hmm.
I never played the SOCOM games. I missed all of those. I know that they were really well liked, and
yeah,
it was a Sony franchise. So, you know, like maybe there's an opportunity to bring that back on a AAA basis. Like, you know, Call of Duty is still a juggernaut, but Call of Duty is down from its. There it is.
I don't know what is this a SOCOM? What are we looking at?
It must be like the original, right?
What we're watching is a camera pointed at a real old TV playing a game.
Fran Mirabella probably filmed this.
Yeah. Someone's reflection is on the CRT.
So. I also love that it's shaky cam. It's not on a tripod. Someone's holding it.
This is fantastic footage. I'm so happy this exists.
This is great.
This is IGN. We built a media empire off of footage like this. I lost my train of thought. Oh, just that, like, so, okay, so Call of Duty is still a monster, you're right, Mark, but it's not, it's down from its peak, right? Like, it's on the downslope. Like, how steep or gradual, or can they turn that downslope around? Maybe, but like, Fortnite is the biggest game on earth, like, you know, biggest shooter on earth. Like, I don't know, like, what competes with Call of Duty is not another Call of Duty, like, it's something else. It's the next version for, like, you know, a take on Apex Legends, or it doesn't even have to be a battle royale, but just like, it's going to be something new and something different. And if you want Call of Duty, like, that's still going to be there for you for the next decade. But I don't think that something else is going to come out that looks like that and feels like that and reaches those same heights. Like, Sony should chart their own course.
Yeah, I agree with that, that I don't think Sony needs to have something to combat Call of Duty, you know, anytime soon. Because as you say, Call of Duty is going to remain on PlayStation for 10 years. 10 years from now, who knows what anything's going to look like? You know, who knows if Call of Duty will even be as popular as it is today. But it did get me wondering. Oh, also, there's that interesting news story from this week where we learned that Redfall was in development for PlayStation 5. And then when Microsoft came in and bought Bethesda, they were like, let's cut that one off. I thought that was very interesting. Yep. A lot of people in the comments, you know, were saying, see? See? Yeah. This is what they're going to do. In my mind, though, they're very different things. Redfall was never, it wasn't even announced, period, first of all, when it was purchased by Microsoft. So nothing was being taken away from PlayStation gamers. Games that are already exist on or have been announced for PlayStation will stay there, and then completely new games like Redfall and Starfield are Xbox exclusives. That makes sense to me, in my mind.
Yeah, I think it's a very funny thing how, like, you know, Naughty Dog and a bunch of studios, Insomniac, they were not first party until they became first party. And now that they're first party, you expect their games to only be on those platforms. So I'm not sure where people are having trouble. It's just because Phil Spencer has said things about, like, we're not looking to take games away from people. But in the next line of that interview that everybody's sourcing, he says, but of course, exclusives are a business move, and we are going to keep some games as exclusive. And so Starfield was the big one where it's like, that game's been in development. You know that there was a PlayStation version. I don't know what that means. There's a something version of every game until they get closer to the end of development, where there's, like, every game's a PC game, right? Until they start working on the different versions. So to assume that Starfield had this, like, PlayStation 5 version ready to go and that Phil Spencer went in and just, like, deleted it is a silly assumption. It's also silly to assume that that game should be on PlayStation. It shouldn't be. They own it. It is what it is.
Yeah. I mean, games reach a size, like, so Insomniac gets acquired and no one expects Insomniac games to be multi-platform anymore, right? Like, it's like, well, no duh. Like, they're owned by Sony now. But then it's like, Call of Duty is big enough. That's the argument, that, right? Like, it's so big that it's inappropriate for it to be a console exclusive, especially after having, you know, the other kind of nuance or detail there is that Insomniac's working on new stuff and new franchises, whereas Call of Duty has, what, 15 plus years of precedence as being, you know, kind of platform agnostic. And so that's another reason why it feels a little bit weird. It's a little bit hard for me to, like, as someone that owns a gaming PC and every console, you know, it's like, but if that's not you, which it's not most people, then obviously you have a little bit more skin in the game and you're a little bit more motivated to care about, you know, exclusivity and how it's kind of bad for consumers.
Mm-hmm. like something almost, you know, bigger than Call of Duty actually is Minecraft. They never went through and took Minecraft off of every platform, even to the point where Minecraft Legends, which comes out next month, has a PlayStation version. They absolutely don't have to do that, but they are still putting Minecraft on every platform. So I don't know. It's a weird argument that Redfall's not on PlayStation. Of course it's not. That makes total sense to me.
Well, thinking about former shooter properties that Sony has that maybe they could bring back. I think Killzone Shadowfall is the last shooter Sony published outside of like VR stuff. And that was a PS4 launch game, so 10 years ago. So I started looking back, and this is when I went down the aforementioned hobbit hole, trying to look at what other first-party games there are. And this led me to compile this list of just forgotten PlayStation games. All of these games now are published by PlayStation. Many of them were also developed by PlayStation.
Wow.
So if you go back
to the... Siphon Filter?
Well, I mean, but that's not forgotten. Don't think. I'm going back. So 1995, the first year that the PlayStation was available, Sony published a first-person shooter called Kiliak, the DNA Imperative, which was a Doom clone that IGN reviewed and gave a 3. So it would have been...
That's what you call a game title.
Yeah.
Kiliak, I remember the DNA Imperative part of that, but I don't remember Kiliak.
Same.
Looking at footage earlier today, it looks fine. It actually has some cool, 90s style FPS music. But IGN gave that a 3.
They were just naming games whatever they wanted back then.
Kiliak.
Whatever. What should we name our game? How about Kiliak? And then again, a room full of people, just like that weird Napoleon man, a room full of people were like, yes, that's the name of our game. It's 1995, and we're going to release our game on the PlayStation and call it that.
They just had dice with all these random names, and they're just rolling it. Like, there you go. There's a game title.
Not even a word.
Even though IGN gave that a 3, Sony published the sequel the following year, and the sequel's called Epidemic.
Whoa, look at that.
Wait, it's just called Epidemic?
Yes.
When aliens invade the Earth, how are they going to be able to put our game collections in order? They'll have no idea that that's the sequel to Kiliak or whatever.
Well, they're going to have any idea that Lords of the Fallen is a sequel to Lords of the Fallen?
Yeah, well, and let's not even get started when they have to catalog Fast and the Furious. They did take out the. Now we'll never know.
Apparently, Epidemic was slightly better than Kiliak because IGN gave that one a 4. I just love that we're...
kept going.
IGN was reviewing that trend would have continued.
IGN was reviewing these early PlayStation games and just trashing them. So that's two games. In the mid-90s, Sony had a first-person shooter franchise already.
Hashtag bring back Kiliak.
Bring back Kiliak.
Get it trending.
And also, when I was looking at this compiling this list, I didn't realize in 1995, Sony released a Twisted Metal, Warhawk, and Wipeout all in that one year.
Ooh, dang.
Yeah, those are all like
decent year.
Key PlayStation franchises. In 1996, Sony developed and published 2Xtreme, which is spelled numeral 2, capital X, Treme.
Sure.
I remember that game.
It's a sequel to ESPN Extreme Games, but does not have the ESPN licensing. Back then, Sony was so much more into sports games. They published their own, and then they had their like 989 Studios. Or 99 Sports, which was their own just, sports creation house. In 1996, Sony published a game called Aquanauts Holiday, which IGN gave an 8.
Oh, wait, I understand. We're just doing weird, forgotten PlayStation games. It's not shooters.
That's where it started, Justin. But now, then I was like, what is this game?
Okay. I was gone for a second, but now I'm back. Now I'm picking up what you're
saying. I was really hoping this was a first-person shooter, though.
Aquanauts Holiday was what? I don't remember. I mean, I recognize the name.
IGN reviewed it. Our review is 2 paragraphs long.
What?
Wow.
I'll read the first paragraph, so half the review. Aquanauts Holiday occupies a peculiar space in the PlayStation's roster of shooters, fighters, and sports games. It's not really any of these. In fact, it's not really a game. What Aquanauts Holiday is, however, is a fun and immersive 3D underwater sim of the most relaxing kind.
Yeah, like that Endless Ocean game that came out on the Wii.
Weird.
Also, so 1996 and IGN reviewed it. That's very early IGN. Mm-hmm.
I know. It would have been, and when we reviewed Kiliak in 95. It would have been under the Imagine Games Network umbrella, yeah. And it was a PS Extreme, whatever, .com.
That was exactly. That would have not been IGN. That would have been the other brand that got folded.
Eventually,
it would
be folded into IGN.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, we're talking about sports games. In 96, Sony developed and published NBA Shootout, NCAA Game Breaker, and NFL Game Day 97.
Whoa.
Developed all those games in-house and published them.
So those used to be all the EA competitors, but there's so few of those now.
Yeah, yeah.
2K.
If you're a younger gamer, it's like it's hard to overstate or like understand just how incredibly dominant the PS1 was as a cultural force throughout like the mid to late 90s. Like cartridges were so expensive to manufacture for game developers, and then therefore the games ended up costing like $70. And then PlayStation just had like these $50 bangers month after month after month of like, you know, it was just a weird time for games, seeing this newcomer come into the market and rise to prominence so quickly.
Mm-hmm. This next one, maybe only Justin would know. In 97, Sony published a game called Carnage Heart. It's a mech-based, turn-based strategy game.
No, I don't remember Carnage
Heart. I never heard of it, but IGN gave it a 9.2. And it sounds totally up my alley.
Wow.
I bet it's expensive now.
I'm sure. It sounds like it'd be like a Front Mission competitor.
Yeah, and I'm sure it has some kind of anime or something like Roots in Japan, but it's just called that here.
Yeah.
This game looks great. I'm looking at it now. Yeah. This game looks awesome.
Right? And then does everyone remember this is Carnage Heart. You're like...
Well, maybe this footage doesn't look so awesome. The game looks fun.
And then does everyone remember the Spawn game?
I do.
I remember it for Super Nintendo. It was a fighting game.
Well, but the one for PlayStation, Sony developed.
Really?
Yes. Sony developed and published the Spawn game for PlayStation. IGN gave that two. That got a 2 out of 10.
Is it not a fighting game, though, on front of PlayStation?
I don't think so.
No, I think it was 3D and you ran around.
Yeah.
And, like, killed people.
Third-person action game.
Medieval Spawn.
Carnage Heart, developed by Art Dink, who is a Japanese game developer who makes some of their own stuff, but mostly pitches in and helps out on other people's games. Mm-hmm. They were one of the primary studios on Triangle Strategy in 2022. Wow.
Still cool. Around.
Cool. In 2000, Sony published three Disney games on the PlayStation 1. Aladdin and Asura's Revenge, Disney Story Studio Mulan, and The Emperor's New Groove. All published by Sony.
Cool.
And then in 2000, Sony published its own Tony Hawk competitor called Grind Session.
Like, I don't remember any of these, dude.
It was apparently okay. IGN gave it a 7.
What year was that?
2000.
Sounds like it was good.
Yeah, good.
Grind Session.
So then moving on to PlayStation 2, in 2002, Sony published Jet X 20, which is a jet ski racing game that's not part of the Jet Moto series. It's just another jet ski racing game. That has Jet in the title. In 2003, Sony published Downhill Domination, which is you know this one?
No, I'm sorry. I think it's Jet X2O.
Oh, okay. Like, you're probably right. H2O. Yeah. Jet X2O. Yeah, you're probably right. Yeah. That's how it's.
And then I remember that like, as I'm trying to look some of these up as you're talking about them, and this game is coming back to me now. It's sort of like a wave race, like.
Yeah. Downhill Domination is an off-road bike racing game that was developed by Santa Monica. So think about it. If that was 2003, the next game they made was God of War.
Yeah.
Sure.
Oh, good frame rate on this.
Yeah, this looks great. And they made, you know, Downhill, that there's a new Downhill BMX game that's pretty popular, right?
Probably.
Ooh.
Cool. All right.
Okay, in 2003, Sony published a Mario Party competitor called My Street. It was from Idle Minds, which 4 years later would make Pain, that we had on Video Game 20 Questions a few episodes ago. And so the description of this on Wikipedia says, in My Street, the player is put in control of the new kid, whose role is to beat the bully before August 24th, the first day of school. It's a party game called My Street.
I almost said, man, I don't remember any of these, but that's kind of the point of this segment.
I mean, the interesting thing about these is like PlayStation, like I described them as the newcomer on the scene, you know, in the 90s, but like they were only making video game consoles about 10 years after Nintendo, right? So like for the 40 or 45 years that video game consoles have been around, PlayStation has been around for like 75% of that time.
Yeah.
Like they're old enough now that they have this history and this legacy of like developed games and published games that's not that different than Nintendo's. They're only really missing one decade. But like, but Nintendo fandom, Nintendo fans, and I say this, you know, with love, are so crazy and like, you know, obsessive over Nintendo and their legacy that like no one ever forgets, you know, like even like old, like obscure Nintendo games like Wrecking Crew, like people know them because they're made by Nintendo, right? Mm-hmm. Like, whereas PlayStation doesn't have, they're old enough now that like, you know, I do this for a living and I had a PS1 and like was reading magazines and stuff at this time. And I barely remember any of these games. Like it's an oddly kind of forgotten legacy.
Yeah. Yeah, I was wondering what a list like this would look like for Nintendo. Like, how many Nintendo games have been forgotten?
Probably Urban Champion.
Not as many.
That one should be forgotten. Does everyone remember the Jet Li game in 2004, Jet Li Rise to Honor? Published by
That Sony. One I do remember.
Published by Sony. In 2006, which one was this? I wrote this down, now I don't remember. There's a game called Tourist Trophy. Oh, yeah. Tourist Trophy is by Polyphony, so Gran Turismo. It's a motorcycle racing game that IGN gave an 8.2. So a great motorcycle racing game from the developer of Gran Turismo that just never got a sequel and that I've never heard of before.
Weird.
Yeah. So in 2006, at the launch of the PlayStation 3, there were some PSN games, some PlayStation Network games.
Yeah.
There was a game called Blast Factor, which apparently wasn't that great, but it was by Bluepoint.
Oh, weird.
Oh, cool.
Who's Bluepoint?
They're the remake studio. They make all the remakes now.
And Blast Factor is, to this day, the only game developed by them that's not a remaster, remake, or port.
That's not just...
That's what I was just going to ask.
That's so funny.
That's their only original product.
That's it. And then in those early years of the PS3, Sony was publishing like actual shovelware onto PSN. I think they were just trying to populate it with games. But some of these games, they're called Go Sports Ski and Go Sports Skydiving. We gave the ski one a 2 and the skydiving a 3. And when you look at these games, they look like the Nintendo Seal of Quantity games that we look at on the show. They're like that bad. Except they're published by Sony. And then in 2009, Sony developed and published a puzzle game on PSN called Numblast. That IGN didn't even review. It was developed and published by Sony. We didn't even review it.
Imagine that happening now.
This is one of the crazier ones. 2009, PlayStation Network, The Punisher, No Mercy. A first-person shooter Punisher game published by Sony. And developed by Zen Studios of Zen Pinball.
Wow.
And then
Did
when
you, play
you
that, like, Daniel?
What's up?
Did you play that? I know you're a Punisher
fan. I don't think so, but because I had no memory of this game. We gave it a 4.2. However, it is another example of Sony publishing a Marvel property.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which they still do today.
Those Disney ones are still surprising to me. Like, I can't believe they had like a straight up the latest Disney movies licensed for a brief period. That's crazy. Yeah.
There's an Aladdin game on the PS1. Who knew?
Yeah. I didn't know that either. Mm.
There's another puzzle game they developed and published for PSN called Trash Panic. Which looks cool.
Yeah.
It's like a falling buck puzzle game, but it's just trash falling into a bin and you have to compact it. You don't ever clear lines. You're just compacting it to keep it from overflowing as long as you can. It looks cool, but I have
How
no
mean
memory
is
of it.
The trash?
Of it. And finally, that brings us to where this all started. A first-person shooter game that Sony could bring back, 2010 Mag.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, that I remember.
Yeah, I remember that too. What it stood for, massive action game or something like that. It was 100 player.
It was
its whole shtick was 100 player. Oh, 256.
Wow. Yeah.
Dang,
so, you know, it's kind of ahead of its time from the Battle Royale standpoint, right?
Yeah, totally.
Yeah. Wasn't terrible. We gave it a 7, but Zipper Interactive went out of business shortly after. Well, I guess they supported it for a few years and then closed up shop.
Yeah. Zipper Interactive was SOCOM, wasn't it? They were, I don't know, like they made some of the SOCOM games, I believe. I'm speaking from memory here, but
I have to look it up. There you have it. That's a little list of forgotten PlayStation games. This is Brad from Georgia. Brad says, growing up, I always played games on Xbox and Nintendo consoles. I never had a PlayStation. Now I have a PS5. I would like to play The Last of Us. But my partner and I are wanting to watch the HBO series as well. I know it's not a situation where you have to do one in order to understand the other, but I was curious if you had any thoughts on which may provide a better experience playing the game before watching the series or after. Mark, what do you think?
I've thought about this a lot because I have people I know that's not done either. And they're like, I want to watch the show. And I'm like, then you're going to spoil the game. And they're like, okay, I'll play the game. I'm like, then you're going to spoil the show. Okay, here's my thoughts. The show exists after the game. So I think you should play the game first because I think the game is the story of The Last of Us. And I think the show is the more of the story of the world of The Last of Us, right? There's so many episodes that and so many scenes and even the episodes that they're featured in that don't focus so much on Joel and Ellie. So if you want to play the first game and get that Joel and Ellie story, great. And then it's like everything about the show is just like a bonus, right? Everything is just like contextual and world building. So yeah, I believe the order that they were released is the order you should watch them if you care that much. I also don't think it really matters that much. That's just my recommendation.
That's a good point. Mm, Sam, yeah. Agreed? Go ahead, Justin.
No, Sam, no.
I'm not a huge fan of the gameplay and the games in the first place. And I think I like the show better. So it's like, I think the game's kind of skippable now. I love the idea of, you know, games having great narrative design, but I don't think that game did. I think it had, you know, okay game design and a good story and a great story perhaps, but like, I don't think they came together that well, and I'd rather just watch it. So we're lucky to have a show that was made this way. It's a real experiment in my philosophy of games, which I'm always telling people, if you're looking for a good story, you probably will find it in a book, a TV show, or a movie instead of a game. Just fine. That is okay. Mm-hmm. Resident Evil 4 is really stupid story-wise, but boy, I cannot stop playing it. I would recommend it to anybody on Earth.
Justin, what were we going to add?
Yeah. Yeah, I think I largely agree with Sam. I'm hesitant to even say this out loud. I don't like the Last of Us game that much. I don't think it's very good. I've tried to play it 3 or 4 times. I find the gameplay boring. You know, you're sneaking around and choking dudes out, and it takes 10 seconds, and you're throwing a brick, and then you're waiting, and then you're throwing another brick and crawling over here, and like, you know, everything that everybody likes about it, from like, you know, the emotional story beats and the acting and the set pieces and all of that, like, you can get that from the show, right? Mm-hmm. Like, I don't think, and I'm not saying the gameplay is like poor, but I also don't think it's exceptional. I don't think that like the act of playing that game and doing those goddamn ladder puzzles, like, it's fine. It's a good video game. And what elevates it is everything else that sort of surrounds the gameplay. And so, you know, watch the show. It's done so well.
Yeah,
well, but I acknowledge that, like, I know that that's a minority opinion, and it won our Game of the Year award for good reason, and so on and so forth. But for me personally, I don't, you know, I didn't find that game to be as exceptional as most of the world did.
I think people really want games to be cinematic, and they really want them to be mature, and I think that gets confused a little bit. And so I think critics and fans that really like game systems and game consoles really want things to prove themselves and be, you know, better than a game. But I think that's bullshit. I think games should stand on their own. And I think, you know, Pac-Man is beautiful and remarkable and amazing. And it doesn't need to be as good as a Spielberg film to be anything but itself. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think we need to let go of that a little bit. And I think a lot of things get a lot of cred, and a lot of things go really wrong when they're trying to tell a really serious story, you know. And some don't. I don't think this goes wrong in telling the story necessarily or anything like that. I just think grafted onto a video game, it makes you a weird mass murderer. And it's like, why does anybody trust Nathan Drake if he's killed 400 people to save a treasure that might tell where his brother is? It doesn't make any sense, you know? Like,
oh,
so,
totally. And it,
I
and
love
it has
those
to
games,
be that
and I'm
way.
Not,
yeah.
not recommending them. I'm saying they should exist, and it's fine.
No, that's completely my stance as well. Where like, you know, the Nathan Drake things exist because the gameplay and shooting is like really fun, right? But like then marrying that with like a Hollywood like story is what can make it weird.
Mm-hmm. Well, and Sony gets a lot of flack for that, right? Because a lot of their games are kind of stole, like they're very cinematic, you know. People say, you know, I didn't play God of War Ragnarok. I watched it because that's just kind of how those games are. I do think the gameplay for games like God of War, and I personally really like The Last of Us and Uncharted. But it is fair to say that Sony does play home to a lot of very cinematic things. And it's okay if that's not for everybody.
Well, hopefully.
I just want to clarify that I don't think cinematic games are bad. What I'm trying is a very nuanced opinion. It's that the games don't have to be cinematic to impress me, and they shouldn't have to be critically acclaimed. That is just not a quality that needs to be held above, say, fun arcade games or something like that. Mm-hmm. It's hard to explain.
I'm picking up what you're putting down. Like there, like so much of the best storytelling, like visual storytelling of all time, relies so much on tight control. Like the way a camera moves in a film can make you feel a certain way, and you know, and but then in a game the player is in control of all of that, and like you know, you wouldn't write in your script like, you know, Nathan Drake tried to climb something for 5 minutes that wasn't climbable and then he moved on, right? Like it's a controlled experience, and when you put that control in the hands of the player, you know, that interactivity, like it can make something scary even scarier, right? Because you're the one running around and running away. But then it can have the opposite effect with certain other types of story. Like, you know, like things that rely on timing, like comedy is really hard to do in games, for example, for that reason. So, you know, like movies exist and TV exists, and I'm not usually looking to video games for big AAA thoughtful storytelling. I can get that from other mediums that do it better. And I prefer my games to be gameplay focused generally. Like I do like, Damon, you talk about lean forward games versus lean back games, and like a lean back game that's like, you know, like an Uncharted that like, I'm just going to go on an adventure and it's going to be breezy and there's going to be cutscenes and gameplay. Like that's cool. That's awesome. Like,
yeah, and then there's storytelling through games like Portal, which like could not be told. Why watch a movie about Portal? Like that doesn't make any sense yet. I can tell anybody what the story is and it's really fun. And then there's things like Unpacking, which like tells a story through like a very, very light gameplay set too. But it's also like, that's a standalone work of art that's cool and interesting. And, you know, is it a good storytelling mode? Sure. That's, it is. It just is, you know?
Agreed. Well, we solved it, Damon.
We have solved it.
We answered that question.
And you can watch Ghost of Tsushima soon, too.
Yeah, that's true.
And I guess God of War. And you can watch all these Sony games.
Twisted Metal.
If you're interested in the story
for that.
Yeah.
But don't watch Halo. Just play those games. They're fine. Mm-hmm. Games are fine for you.
That brings us to Video Game 20 Questions. Our suggestion this week comes from JC from Elon, North Carolina. Elon, Ellen, E-L-O-N. Let the questioning begin.
Do we think it's published by Sony? Should we ask?
Oh, actually, sorry.
His hobbit hole?
Sorry, JC has a little note for us. Has been watching, listening for years, through 2 marriages in the past 10 years to be exact, while cleaning, relaxing at night, while doing brain dead tasks and games. You guys are a big positive part of my week. I've seen members come and go. I know you've grown families, and I've discovered great games from GameScoop approved games like The Eternal Castle. That is an awesome game. Okay, now you may let the questioning begin.
I like the little blurbs because it tells us something. It's like JC is not a young gamer. Mm-hmm. He's an elder statesman of gaming. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Is it Eternal Castle?
Was this game released in the 70s, 80s, or 90s?
No.
Oh.
Okay.
I really wish we'd get more 70s games.
Centipede.
Was this released on the Magnavox Odyssey?
That's 80.
Yeah, I was going to say Centipede was like 80, wasn't it?
Asteroids, though.
Yeah.
Did this game have an overlay I had to stick to my TV?
Yeah, exactly. Okay, so was this published, was this a first, what do we say, a console exclusive?
Yes, it was.
Okay, now we just got to figure out which console. Let's see here.
Was it on PlayStation fam?
Was it a on the PlayStation
Yeah, this PlayStation family of home consoles and portable consoles.
No.
Okay.
Was it exclusive to a Nintendo console?
Yes.
Here we go.
We got this.
Was this published by Nintendo?
Yes. That's five.
Damon was just talking about how everybody knows all of the Nintendo published games.
Here we go.
Except it's for Fortune Mario. Street. People don't know what Fortune Street is.
Okay. Yeah. Does the main character of this game, is he in a Smash Bros?
Yes.
Or she.
Or she. Sure. Okay. Okay. That
so
was
not
a
Fortune
good
Street.
That was a good six questions.
Feeling all right. Okay. Was this game exclusive to the Wii?
No.
Rip.
Did this game come out on a disc format?
No.
Switch. Yes.
DS, 3DS. It can't be. It wasn't released in the 90s, so I guess it could be like late GBA.
Okay. Well, I almost
was this game
up
displayed? Was this a handheld game?
Yes.
Okay.
It's Steel Diver.
I love it.
Okay. I mean, was this a Nintendo DS exclusive?
No. That's 10.
So it's got to be 3DS.
Right? Okay.
Do we have to burn a question on that, or can we assume?
Let's assume for now.
Okay.
Okay. Let's see.
Is this game known for making use of like a 3D?
But it could be Switch also.
Right. Oh, yeah.
Well, he said handheld. Would you consider Switch a handheld?
Yes.
It's a hybrid.
It's the eternal struggle.
Yeah.
It's a home console that
you can play handheld.
Correct. That's how I read it.
We can burn a question on.
Okay.
Can we eliminate two out of three of the GBA, 3DS, and Switch somehow?
Well, so we know it's not DS. So what we're left with is maybe Switch, maybe 3DS, maybe a weird late GBA game, although that would...
Yeah, it's so unlikely, I know.
Yeah.
But you could pair Metroid Fusion with Metroid Prime. That came out in 2002.
What year did the Nintendo Switch come out?
2017. So yeah, we just need to eliminate one of those decades.
Was this game released on a console that was first released in 2017? Did this game make it? Okay.
So 3DS more than likely, unless it's an old GBA.
It's totally 3DS.
Okay.
Steel Diver. So Steel Diver, just going down that route. That was a DL downloadable. Oh, no, that was on cartridge, right?
It was a launch game, right?
It was on cartridge.
Okay. 3DS games, you know, there's obviously the obvious one. There's, you know, there's Animal Crossing. Mm-hmm. There's Mario 3D Land.
Yeah.
Zelda.
We could ask if this is part of a giant series or just part of the Mario series or part of the Zelda series or something.
Yeah, and we know that the character is in Smash Bros.
Yeah.
Because the big series, like... games with more than 10 games, like Zelda and Mario, and then there's smaller series like Metroid, which is like probably 15 games.
What was the Fire Emblem on 3DS? I'm assuming there was one.
Yeah, Awakening was one of them, and then Fates, I believe, is there's the three one.
I don't even know.
Mm-hmm.
There are some Kirby's on 3DS.
Yeah,
Link Between Worlds.
There's a lot of 3DS games, huh? I don't know. Is this part of the Mario universe?
Yeah, it's a little bit of a gray area, but I think you have to say yes.
So Donkey Kong, Tropical Freeze, something, something.
They ported Returns to 3DS, but that wouldn't... Damon said it was a 3DS exclusive, and Returns was like a port. I mean, there was some weird, there was Mario Party Mario Party 100 or whatever that weird thing was.
A party game.
Sports.
WarioWare.
Was
I don't even skip the 3DS. I mean, there is a game for it, but it's like a really strange one.
Does this game have Mario in the title of the game?
No.
Well, it's not Mario Tennis. It's not Mario Party. It's not Mario Kart. It's not Mario Golf. It's not Mario and Sonic at the Olympics.
Well, and it's likely to just not feature Mario at all, but just in the Mario universe.
Mm-hmm. It's not Mario and Luigi.
What are the? Are there any Donkey Kong games on 3DS that are not that port? I don't think so. I mean,
where it's like almost, it's like the old arcade game. What's that game called? I forget. I don't even remember if it's a 3DS game.
If it's a GBA game and it's like, you know, Donkey Kong King of Swing or something, one of the last GBA games.
Dude, that's not a bad call. That's not a bad thought.
So do we need to burn it and be like, is this a 3DS game?
Well, let's just do, is this a Donkey Kong game?
Okay.
Is this a Donkey Kong game?
No.
No, okay.
There was a...
Captain Toad Treasure Tracker, but that was also a port, right?
No, that was the original.
That was on Wii U or something?
I thought it started on 3DS and then got ported to Wii U, but maybe it was the other way around.
I think it was just on Wii U and got ported to Switch. I don't think it's ever been portable. Maybe it has, though. I don't know.
3DS got that, well, but again, it's a port, but it got the NES Remix compilation.
Mm-hmm.
3DS got a Yoshi Island.
There's Dr. Luigi.
Yeah.
It's unclear.
There's the Luigi Ghost game.
Super Luigi U and Luigi's Mansion.
Yeah, the second one.
It's probably Luigi's Mansion Dark Moon.
Is this a Luigi game?
No. That's 15.
Oh, right. No.
Could it be Bowser's Inside Story? No, that's a Mario.
But Mario Luigi.
Oh, I should clarify. Yeah. A while back, Justin said, Damon said it's an exclusive 3DS game. And just, I never said that.
Okay.
But we know it was a console exclusive. And we know it was on a Nintendo console. And we know it's not on the Switch or DS, and we know it came out after in the year 2000 or later.
Yeah, but I think he's basically saying like it could be, which it's not because this isn't placed in the Mario universe, but like it could be Ocarina of Time 3D, because like technically that game is exclusive to Nintendo but not exclusive to 3DS. So I think that would still fit in the criteria, but that's not a Mario game.
I'm calling the cops if that's the case. I mean, or Damon's giving us a clue that it's a after 2000 GBA game.
It's a Mario adjacent game, and it has characters in Smash Brothers. I'm just trying to focus on like,
what if it's Smash Brothers on 3DS?
Super Smash Brothers for 3DS.
That would be awesome, yeah, Damon. Even if it's not that, change it to that, just so we can have this moment.
I'm still. I know I've brought it up on this show before, but I'm so mind blown that the fourth Smash Brothers is Super Smash Brothers 4 3DS and Super Smash Brothers 4 Wii U. Yeah, it blows me away every time I forget and re-remember that fact.
Mm-hmm. Do you perform Super Smashes in this game?
No.
Damn it. Damn, that would have been so funny. boy.
This is confusing. I don't know where to go.
I mean, I don't hate DK King of Swing.
But it's not a DK game.
No.
We asked
Donkey Kong.
So we know it's not a Mario in the title game or a Donkey Kong in the title game. Or just a Donkey Kong game. Which is like, what else is Mario adjacent that could be like that? Well, there's the Wario games. That's all I'm thinking about still. Who else? Like Toad had his own games. Super Princess Peach was on DS.
What about a Yoshi game? Is there not a Yoshi game for 3DS?
Yoshi, that's good.
There is a Yoshi game.
Well, I don't know what it would be, though.
I know. I don't remember what it's called. It's not Yoshi Island 2. They did. I mean, it might just be like, so they did. They did new Super Mario Brothers. Like, did they, was there a game? Was there a new like new Yoshi Island game?
Is that a thing? There was on DS, and it had Baby Donkey Kong and Baby Peach in it. But I don't remember anything for 3DS. So it gets a little confusing.
Maybe I agree.
I don't know where to go. I mean, it could still be GBA. You know.
I started this podcast with so much confidence in this.
How many questions do we have?
Four. Three questions and a guess.
Man, and not having Mario in the name, like that, you know, that knocks out any sort of like weird, you know, Paper Mario, like any of those.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah.
Ooh, there was Yoshi's Woolly World.
Hey.
Yeah, that's good. We could ask if you play as a human.
We wouldn't consider Kirby in the Mario universe at all, right?
No.
Okay.
Do you play as a human in this game?
Human? I guess so.
Okay. Well, if it was Yoshi's Woolly World, he would have not had to think about that at all.
I think it's Toad.
What do you mean human? I guess so. Please to explain.
Is Toad a human? I guess so.
No, he's not.
He's definitely not.
I don't know. I think it's ambiguous.
It might be like Wario, because it's like, is Mario Wario? Like, are they humans?
Yes.
Are they, though? Because yes. You go to New Donk City and you meet humans and they don't look anything like you.
It's okay.
So you ever...
They got pulled into the warp pipe when they're fixing their plumbing company. We all know that.
Okay, after a little research, this is a human character.
So, there was WarioWare on the GBA, on the
DS. Yeah, but it's like WarioWare, like some weird game assembly game.
Yeah, what about like Punch-Out? Like, he would know that like Little Mac is a human.
Yeah, like, that's not set in the Mario. He's not even couldn't even possibly be in the Mario universe.
Wait, I thought Mario was the referee in those games, or at least in the original.
That's true, but they're not.
That's more of like an.
That's a good point. And Donkey Kong's in the background in Punch-Out. I don't know. I don't know why this is so difficult.
When he said Nintendo, I was like, "Oh, this will be easy."
Mm-hmm. Yeah, me too. We don't miss Nintendo.
It's a little bit of a hard mode one. There's definitely weirder games in the DS, like Yoshi Touch and Go, and
yep,
like that. So this is pretty difficult.
Just trying to figure out like who would Damon have to look up to find out if they were human.
Maybe I think it might be the WarioWare game. I can't remember what it's called.
Yeah, WarioWare Inc. I don't remember.
Yeah, that's right. You got it. That's what it's called.
No, WarioWare Inc.'s the original one, isn't it? That's just maybe. The very original WarioWare game.
Yeah. Mm.
It's called like it has, I don't know. It's called like Let's Make It or something. It's not I'm thinking Shake It, but like it's called
something. Okay. Mm. What about Tomodachi Life?
There was also a WarioWare that was like a best of that they ported to Switch. Yeah, Tomodachi Life. What a game.
All right, two questions and a guess.
Okay, well, should we just burn one for Wario?
Yeah.
Okay, is this a Wario game?
Yes.
Hey, okay, so now we just have to figure out which one that is. Wait, but was there one on GBA?
Hey, I think that was the first original one on GBA.
It's so that would have definitely been more in the 90s, yeah?
Yeah.
Well,
it got ported to GameCube also with multiplayer.
Yeah, it did. The very original WarioWare was called WarioWare Inc. Mm-hmm. Micro Mega Games or whatever it was. Yeah. And it was GBA, and then you're right, it got ported to GameCube.
Okay, well then we should ask if it was on GBA first.
That's our last question.
We still have a question?
We have one question.
Oh yeah, then we got this. Yeah.
Okay.
Is this on GBA first?
Yes.
All right, that's
yeah,
it.
it's WarioWare Inc.
Maybe it's not, though.
No, it is not.
No!
So Wario, what is it?
That's what it's called.
You all made a fatal error. The Game Boy Advance was released in 2001.
Yeah. Oh. No, I knew that. But we got
the game right. That's the GBA one.
So it wouldn't be a late. It didn't have to be a late GBA game. It's Wario.
We said WarioWare Inc.
It's Wario Land 4.
Oh no.
Wario Land 4.
This is great.
I don't think we made a fatal error. Like, okay, look, yes, you're right. We made an error about the GBA, but we guessed a GBA WarioWare game. That was our guess.
Well, our thing is that we had three consoles, GBA, Switch, and 3DS, and we annihilated. We got rid of Switch, and we're stuck on that. We should have.
Yeah.
This game is getting a little bit of a renaissance right now because there's a spiritual successor to it.
Right.
Pizza Tower.
Yeah.
I just watched a YouTube essay about this game. I've never played it. It's like one of the few games in my Nintendo backlog that like I hope to get to someday.
Well, shows up in the new Switch online.
Yeah. It's got great pixel art. This is a really good game.
The animations are wild, especially when he walks up a ladder.
Yeah. Craig Harris gave this a 9.
Yeah, well, that means it was mediocre at best.
No. It's good. I've played this.
Oh, man, it looks great.
I can vouch for it. Yeah, you seem to just discount the GBA because you thought maybe it was released in the late 90s or something.
Well, we kept coming back to the GBA. I want to point that out, but I know what you mean.
Yeah, I agree. We were a little too fixated on 3DS.
Yeah. Look at those Mode 7 effects. Anyway, nicely attempt. Thank you for your suggestion. Who was that? JC in Elon, North Carolina. I think that's what I said. Viewers, listeners, if you have your own suggestions or for 20 questions or questions for the show, email them to me at the address gamescoop@ign.com. And that is all the scoops that we have for you this week. Thank you, Sam. Thank you, Justin. Thank you, Mark. Thank you to everyone working behind the scenes in our LA studio to make this episode possible. My name is Damon. This is IGN Gamescoop, and we're out.
Stop talking shit about Star Trek then.
My run of show came together very last minute, so nobody knows what we're going to talk about, but that's okay.
I'm well aware.
Yeah, I mean, I don't really look at them anyway, so I'm at no disadvantage.
If it's Resident Evil, I'm good. If it's not, we're screwed. I got nothing.
No, we already did Resident Evil, Mark.
Yeah, we talked about it last week, but I do want to get your thoughts on it, Mark.
You're going to have to fall back on your natural charms.
This is the worst case scenario.
And you're going to have to win 20 questions.
Fuck.